That was so abruptly interrupted last time. I'll remind you of everyone. We were discussing five to the fourth theory and four minus epsilon dimensions. Space-time dimensions. So V is 4 minus epsilon. And we were discussing the equation of the beta function for the five to the fourth boundary. And we found that V4 by V, where I scale T, as in our earlier discussions, flow towards the IR. Okay? So it decreases is equal to minus, what was it, 3 by 16 pi squared, t squared. Okay, it's plus epsilon. You remember this? You remember we plotted the flow lines, yeah? And we saw that plus, of course, 4 to g cube. We saw that the flow lines went like this, they went. The G4 flow lines went outwards around G equals 0. That's simply the fact that this epsilon this term is positive. And then went inwards around this new minimum. I can't remember the value of the minimum, but it was all right. Okay. This was the issue. This was G4. There was also the mass square operation. So the flow lines went like this. This guy. For this guy, it's clear that an order epsilon is something that's dimension, whose dimension of relevance is a dimension 1 operator, mass square term, and it will be corrected maybe 1 plus or minus epsilon. Okay, so it will clearly stay relevant. So the flow lines look like this. The main point of interest was this new fixed point. The main point of interest was this new fixed point. And we just started discussing why that was interesting. Well, it's interesting from many points. Okay? But we started discussing why it was interesting from the point of view of statistical physics. We described how several phase transitions, for instance, the phase transition in the Ising model as a function of its coupling, just a three-dimensional Ising model, just as a classical statistical mechanics model, as a function of the coupling, the coefficient between Si dot Sj. Okay? For instance, that model has a phase transition, which plausibly is governed by when you're in the neighborhood of the phase transition point by some sort of block spinning. Plausibly, the fact that S is discrete doesn't matter. You get an effective continuous field. So it's governed by some path integral involving a scalar field in three dimensions. Okay, we know nothing else about it. Okay? But it's some path integral involving a scalar field in three dimensions. And now, what do we know about this model? We know, sort of from various means, numerical simulations, blah, 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 that mean field method, that many things tell you that as you change this coupling, so in other words, the model was simply Si dot Sj, nearest anywhere Si dot Sj chain, and as you change this chain, as you change this J, we've seen that there is a phase transition point. We go from a phase in which the S's have expectation value to a phase in which the S's so non zero expectation value. Okay, magnitude transition. So phase transition of ferromagnetism. And we know that the phase transition itself is second order. And in the neighborhood of that phase transition, there's no length scale. Things vary on very large distances. So that's the neighborhood of that fixed point that can plausibly be described by a continuum. Okay? Because any theory in which your correlation functions are dying off, let's say 10 lattice spacings, will be very far from a continuum theory. Because continuum theory is no knowledge of the lattice. Something where the correlation functions are dying off on a million lattice spacings should be well approximated after correcting score of 1 over a million or a million squared by continuum theory. Okay. So it's the neighborhood of this fixed point that should be well described by continuum field theory. We were going to try to identify the field theory.
Can we a priori say that this is
the same transition? Can we a priori? Well, you know, no, it's very hard to know without knowing anything.
Yeah.
But for instance, if you do a mean field analysis of the Ising modulus, all of you have done in statistical mechanics courses, that very simply shows that it's a second order phase.
Yeah, I know that, but can you just see from here?
No, no, you can't. You see, given a Lagrangian, you can't even know whether there's phase transition or not. You have to do some analysis.
Even with the knowledge of the phase transition?
No, no, no. Okay. If, you see, the only situation in which the phase transition will be described by continuum field theory is when the phase transition is second. Why is that? You see, so let me remind you. In a Landau-Ginzburg picture, a first order phase diagram, phase transition, is something like this. You've got a minimum, and there's another minimum. As you change a parameter, the height of that other minimum increases, some point becomes equal to the first, and then it becomes lower. So you make a transition from this to this. What is this diagram? There's some order parameter. It's like a potential as a function of phi. Effective quantum potential as a function of phi. Okay? Theories like to sit at the minimum of the effective action. As you change your parameter, this effective potential changes. And you make a transition from the theory like this here to the theory like this here. Now, this is a first order phase transition, sometimes called a discontinuous phase transition. What is it called? A discontinuous phase transition. So, discontinuous because your configuration, phi, jumps discontinuously from zero to some non zero vector as it goes from the phase transition curve. Okay? And this leads to a high order discontinuity in derivatives of the free energy. The free energy is always continuous. Because what we're plotting here is the free energy, that's the phase transition curve, the free energy side. Okay? But the first derivative of the free energy changes, this is discontinuity. Okay? This is our phase, first order phase transitions. Now, of relevance to us is the issue that when a first order phase transition is happening here, this phase locally is still massive. Both phases that you transit to are massive phases. See, there's a non-zero curvature of your potential. There's no particular reason to expect for a first order transition any scale invariance in your problem around the scale that phase transition part. Now let me remind you, in contrast, of second order phase transitions. The second order phase transition is like a potential that does this. Then, at the phase transition point, the phi square term goes to zero. So just phi to the 4. And then, it does this. Infinitesimally near the phase transition where it's just before the phase transition. So there it is. Just after the phase transition. You see, this is a continuous phase transition.
Yeah,
you go a little bit away from phase transition, phi changed a little bit away from zero, but not discontinuous. Okay, that results in a second derivative of the free energy. That's the connection with the normal thing, but of much more importance to us is the fact that it phase transition happens via the production of a massless quantum. A mass square is going to zero. So, the theory of this scalar field, after you integrate out all the other massive degrees of freedom, will be described by, will have no length scale. So it's only these second order phase transitions in a Lattice system that plausibly have a quantum field theory. It's clear that first order phase transitions don't exist. All correlation functions are basically finite in Lattice units. And so there's no possibility of a continuum field theory. Okay?
Is this the same statement as a Bostrom theorem?
Is this the same statement as a Bostrom theorem? No, no. You see, here we have a massless field, even though there is no continuous symmetry that's been there. These are very different statements. Okay? In this particular case, in the symmetry broken phase, there is no massless field. What is the Goldstone theorem? The Goldstone theorem tells you that when you've got a continuous symmetry, in a symmetry broken phase, you must have massless field. Why is the Goldstone theorem proven? It's obvious. You see, because you've broken your symmetry, so there's some symmetry direction that is a symmetry of the theory but moves the vacuum. So moves it in some direction which doesn't change the energy. It's a massless theory. Okay? Because it's a continuous. Here, the only symmetry we have is a discrete symmetry. Phi goes to minus phi, s goes to minus s. So there was no continuous symmetry, there was no Goldstone theorem, and in particular, we see that in the massive, that in this massive phase, there is no massless. I mean, in the symmetric broken plane, there's no massless field. Okay? Nonetheless, there is a massless field occurring at the phase transition. Okay? Now, something that's very important here is that this massless degree of freedom happens as you take tune J to J gradient. So it requires, in the space of the UP theories, a one-parameter tune. Now, say we're near the phase transition point, but not at it. So that the continuum quantity theory discussion is better. Okay? Now, let's say the lattice scale, the inverse lattice scale, is some lambda. Okay? We're measuring physics at some lambda, which is much larger. Because we're near the phase transition. Otherwise, this would be an empty state. To measure, always measure at much larger distance, what we get is zero. All quadratures will align. Okay? So, we're measuring this, and the way we. So, let's say we're at, you know, 1,000 times larger than the lattice scale, so that there's some effective continuum field theory description. And what we get is some effective continuum field theory description at scale lambda naught, which is some function of the state. To actually compute that would be vector. Actually take this block spinning procedure through and so on to find the continuum field theory description, that's let's say 1,000 or 1 million less. Okay, it'd be very tough. But there's something. Okay, what does that mean? It means that at scale lambda, all the parameters of our effective action, I think we call them x, n, d, at scale lambda naught, is equal to some x, x and d of j. You don't know what it is. It's a function of one parameter. Because the original theory of one parameter. Is this clear? Okay. Now, as we change j, we're drawing some one parameter, some line in the space of all these components. Okay? And as we change this line, one point on this line undergoes the phase transition. Now, what does this mean? This means that that unless there's a terrible conspiracy going, this means that the space of flows have the property that there is a co-dimension one surface, such that on that co-dimension one surface, all flows lead to the phase point. Because the phase transition itself is the continuum description of phase transition itself is the phase point. Okay? So your renormalization group flows lead to the fixed point on a co-dimension one surface. Is this clear? Not yet. Okay? Let's say, what are we doing? We're starting with this description of the renormalization group. And then flowing down to much larger energies. Okay? What do we know? We know the neighborhood of the fixed point is almost massless theory. Correlation functions are very large. I mean, or a diagonal of very long. At the fixed point, we've got masses scale limit. So when J is J critical, we've got a scale limit. So the description of that scale limit theory is the fixed point. So what does that mean? That once we are at J equals J critical, we run the renormalization group flow to very long distances. We will have reached the fixed point. Is this clear? So there is a co-dimension once surface on the space of renormalization group flows, which when flowed down to low energies, it's a fixed point. Now, let's try to relate this to what we know about fixed points. Okay? Let's do it in the neighborhood of the fixed point. In the neighborhood of the fixed point, what gives you the co-dimension of the space in the space of flows that reaches the fixed point? But the only flows that don't reach the fixed point, the only directions that go away from the fixed point, directions that are characterized by relevant of things. So the co-dimension of the space of flows that will hit exactly the fixed point is the number of relevant vectors of the field. Is this clear? So very important. Okay. Co-dimension, sorry, this is string theorist talking, sorry. you should hate these things when people use words they didn't understand. Go down to space. Suppose you're in a space which has dimension A. You've got a manifold that's dimension A.
Dimension
A. The co-dimension of the manifold is dimension. It's definition. Okay? So the co-dimension of a line on a plane is 1. The dimension of the line on the plane is also 1. But the co-dimension of a line in 3 space is 2. The dimension of the line means 1. Now the other, the co-dimension of a plane in 3 space is 1. Okay? So co-dimension 1 surface is something that can be given by one equation, just one condition. Is this clear? Okay? Now why do I say that if I do a one-parameter tuning, yeah, let's explain this. Why do I say that if I do a one-parameter tuning, if I do a one-parameter tuning, let's take lower dimensions. Suppose we've got two lines on a plane. Generically, they meet at points. On the other hand, like two lines in 3 space. Generically, they don't meet. On the other hand, if I had a line and a plane in 3 space, generically, they meet at a point. Can you see that there's a general rule that if you've got two surfaces, subsurface, you've got a space of dimension. If you've got two subsurfaces of dimension n1 and n2. Generically, you would expect them to meet at points. Only if n1 plus n2 is equal to n. We're concerned by one of these n1s is 1. Because we've got a line. What was our line? Our line was the line of initial conditions. Labeled by G. Okay? So we've got one line and some other surface. And we know that these meet at a point. Can you see it? It's just like in 3 dimensions. Can you see it? This means that that surface should have dimension d minus 1. Now, in particular, the d here is infinity, so I don't want to say infinity minus 1. But co-dimension is very different.
So, two lines can also meet in a three-dimensional.
They can be, but it requires a choice. Suppose I write down a random line and another random line. They will not. You see that I've drawn a line, yeah? You shut your eyes and draw another line. You will not meet. You'll have to have a conspiracy now. Let's say let's say this in terms of equations.
Is this guaranteed on a two-dimensional space? Like it's true for on a flat space?
We're talking about generically. Let's say in terms of equations. How many equations do you need to specify a line? In 3 dimensions. You need 2 equations. Can you see that? One equation would specify a plane, and another equation on that plane would specify a line. Okay? So one line is specified by 2 equations. The second line is specified by 2 equations. Total number of equations? 4. Total number of variables? 3. Typically, 4 equations for 3 variables have no solution, which means the lines are moving. Okay, this kind of equation counting will tell you that generically, you expect what I'm saying. Is this clear? In D dimensions, you would require D minus 1 equations to specify a line. But one equation to specify a co-dimensional surface. So D minus 1 plus 1 is D. Generically, the solutions.
So,
when
you talk about space of algebras,
yes.
Each algebra will identify the set point, right?
With it, if it has an edge, some just go off. Most go off. But one.
So what I mean was that. I expect the space of algebra to be two-dimensional. So the fixed point will come as a co-dimensional true surface.
The space of RG flows is two-dimensional. But the space of RG flows is infinite dimensional.
RG flows?
Yeah, because you can start with any dimension.
Okay.
You see, there are two different things. There's A, the space of flows. B, the space of this. The dimensionality of the attractor. Okay? The surface that we started from in the U could be anything.
Yes.
This is infinite dimension space. Flows are labeled by the initial conditions.
Yes.
Infinite number of initial conditions. Okay? Now, suppose you've got a fixed point such that all except one operator are given.
Yeah.
Okay. You have to reach this region so that the relevant operator is tuned to zero. That's the point you. Okay? So we have concluded, if you can stretch out. No, then we don't have to. We have two relevant operators here.
Who are relevant?
But we're looking at this. Actually, that was the point. But you see, at the moment, all I said was that we know that the Ising one is described by a fixed point with one relevant operator. Why do we know that? We know that because we have to do just one tuning to hit the fixed point. Okay? Now, you could ask, which of these fixed points of either could be the fixed point that describes the phase transition of the S? Could it be this? No, unless there's a conspiracy. Okay? Because this is two relevant operators. Could it be this? Yes. So that's one bit. Okay? This is the only known fixed point in three-dimensional theory of three-dimensional scalars with one relevant operator. Therefore, the Ising model at its phase transition point. Okay? The Ising model at its phase transition point presumably is governed by this. Okay. Now, most of this lecture is going to be dedicated to the study of this model in the large element, where we can exactly solve it. Before doing that, I wanted to go through some of the physics. The people who were the Stanbeck people here will know what I'm saying. But somehow, IMG people are sometimes very uneducated about phase time. So I wanted to tell you some of the physics people. Okay. What I want to know is the following. You know, in the neighborhood of the phase of a phase transition, you get many interesting problems. People who study phase transitions, experimentalists who study phase transitions, often measure these problems. And it was in the 60s, one of the goals of the theoretical understanding of phase transitions to try to explain these problems. They were funny, interesting problems. But they were universal problems in the form that I will explain. So it seemed clear that this was a problem, you know, that should be amenable to theorists and analysts because of universality. But it was not trivial because the powers weren't half a one. It was something interesting. It was one of the great triumphs of quantum field theory. Was that it explained these powers? I want to explain to you how that works. Okay, so I'm now going to look at a blow up of this fixed point. Forget about the other fixed point. Okay, it's not relevant. Okay, and so this is our fixed point, and the flows are going. This is the attractor surface. Okay, so if you start it out here, you would hit the fixed point. So your physics would be scaled. That's you. Go to the infrared. Now, at this point, suppose we've got this J. Okay? This J. There's some value of J. So we've got some phase, some line in the space of all initial conditions. That is a function of J, and at J is equal to J critical. This line exists. This attractive point space. Okay. And now the question that you at this point, so suppose we compute the correlation length. So what is the correlation length you compute? A two-point correlator, let's say 5-5 correlator. And it divergence exponentially as e to the power minus r by sigma. Sigma is called a correlation length. Length scale over which interactions behave. Okay? Suppose you've got this correlation length, it's some function of j. Now, we know that at j equals jc. a J equals J critical, zeta is equal to infinity. Okay, question. Suppose J is equal to JC plus delta C. How does sigma behave as a function of delta C? Zeta behave as a function. Actually, I'm a little challenged with Greek letters. Whenever I don't know what a Greek letter is, I call it zeta. I hope this really is zeta. That's what happens. Okay.
Isn't JC a fixed point? Like, how can, what's the difference?
J is what you have in your model, the parameter of your model. Mm-hmm. Now, as you change J, maybe in the description of your model, your correlation will change.
Okay, but when you're written J is JC plus delta JC, does it mean that you talk of a delta JC or delta J?
Thank you. Delta J. So we've got zeta and delta J, and we want to know how it behaves. It's clear that it diverges as delta J goes to zero. But how does it diverge? This is a question we're going to try to answer. Okay. Now, you see, what we understood about renormalization of overflows helps us understand the answer to the question very, very simply. Yeah, and that's what I'm going to try to explain. You see, as we change this JC, this delta JC, a little bit away from here, what we're doing in particular is changing. You see, this flow is something complicated, but once we follow it to the neighborhood of this region, all the irrelevant stuff is damped. Okay, so once we follow it to the neighborhood of the streets, we've reached all the irrelevant stuff is dampened. Then the remaining flow is simply in this relative direction. Is this clear? So, we take this J, we change J by from JC by delta JC. And what we want to know is, then you wait for a long time. Wait till you reach scale lambda, let's say. Okay? What we want to know is this. Okay, what we know in general is this. We know that, so let's call this the coefficient of this norm, this operator, whatever it is, let's call it x2. If dimensionless coefficients. Okay, we want to know, we know that an x2 of lambda has takes the form x2 0, some a, times lambda by lambda naught to the power mu. Okay? Or let's say in this case we call it three. Pretty much. I'm not using standard index manner notation because there are some particular notation for these powers which I don't remember. But I mean the fine R notation. In R notation, mu is equal to the dimension of the relative. I'm using the way. Okay? We've seen this, right? Something has scaling dimension. Yeah. This. Right. So dimension. Four operators and four dimensions didn't scale. Okay? So, we know that once we wait for long enough time, once lambda becomes much, much smaller, lambda naught. It was bigger. Okay. We know that it takes this form. So, this A here is going to be some function of delta J. Okay? And there seems no reason to suspect that it's anything but linear. Because nothing funny is happening in this renormalization. When delta J was 0, A was 0. Okay? When delta J is non-zero, since there's no non-analyticity of any sort. Okay? The generic expectation, and you can see this in various toy model examples of renormalization, okay? Seems, unless something very special is happening, you would expect to spend the logic of Taylor analysis. Okay? That this A here was a linear function of delta j. So this is delta j times some number, if you know. If you feel uncomfortable about this, you can work out sample toy models to see that this is just generically true. Just Taylor expansion. The most general analytic function that is 0 at delta j equals 0. Well, that's basically what it is. And there's nothing non-analytic about the flows. Okay. Now this is interesting. This is interesting for the populace. You see, what this tells us is that if I started with two different values of delta j, but suppose I want to get to the same value of x2, I'm going to have to change my lambda. So delta j happens at a particular lambda naught. The lambda naught is the lattice scale. That's not in my hands. Okay? If I want the renormalization proof flow to take me to the same theory, the theory is defined by my x2. Okay? I have to change lambda. How do I have to change lambda? Lambda is proportional to 1 over x2 to the power 3 minus 2. Lambda, so fixed, keep x2 fixed. Okay? Is proportional to delta j to the power 1 over 3 minus 0. Okay? Let's see if this is going in the right direction. As we make delta j smaller and smaller, lambda becomes smaller and smaller. This is the constant power. Okay? What is that? That's reasonable. Because you see, if delta j was 0, we would be bang on this line. So you'd have to flow for an infinite amount of time to get to any non-zero x2. Alright? As you make delta j smaller and smaller, we're nearer and nearer to fixed manifold. So we have to flow for longer and longer to reach a particular x2. Okay. But now remember that our renormalization group flows, when we said two theories were the same, they were always the same when all units were measured in units of lambda. Okay? So, what we found is the following. That the scale that we have to move to, so that in particular implies that zeta, you see, when we got to the same point of the renormalization group flow, the two correlation lengths, for instance, are same in units of lambda. But the lambdas are not the same. Okay? So what we have is that zeta divided by lambda is some function of x2. Okay? We've done the scaling so that x2 is fixed. So in particular, this means zeta times, because zeta is a length and lambda is energy. So zeta times lambda is some function of x2. Okay? So zeta is equal to some number, we don't know what this function of x2 is, divided by lambda. But lambda is proportional to this. So zeta is proportional to delta j to the power minus 1 by 3. Concluded that as we change change the parameters, okay, as we change the parameters of our model a little bit away from the fixed point, the correlation then will scale like delta J to this. And in particular, this exponent is completely determined by the scaling dimension of the unique relevant property. Yeah, this is the exact scale.
Okay.
Okay, it's the in the renormalization group equations around the fixed point, dg by dt is equal to something times g. That number. After we take all the corrections. Okay, this is a conceptual analysis.
But the point is, if you write dg by dt is something proportional to t, then the thing is.
Yeah, it's something proportional to g.
Something proportional to g. The proportionality constant depends on t,
right? No. That's a very important point. The renormalization equations are local. Dg by dt as an exact scale is a function only of g's.
Okay.
There's no memory about where you came from.
Okay.
Right? Once you know where you are, you know how to move. Okay? It's a very important structural feature of renormalization. That we discussed in one of the early lectures. Right? dg by dt is a function of g. This is an exact statement about the exact infinite dimensional generalization. Okay? Excellent. Now, we did this for correlation. Oh, by the way, you see that this divergence. Okay? Now, suppose you were interested in computing, people are interested in computing specific heats sometimes. Okay? Then you say that you would do exactly the same analysis. You just have to know what the dimensionality of that specific heat, the quantity you're interested in computing is. Okay? You want to know what the dimensionality of the quantity you're interested in computing is. Okay? Quantity scaled by lambda to the appropriate power, the power given just by its naive dimensionality. Okay? That quantity scaled by lambda to the appropriate power is fixed. Therefore, the quantity behaves like lambda to the appropriate power, but then lambda is replaced by delta j to the power 1 over 3 minus k. We did it. For example, for a correlation length, which was an object of length, of dimension length. But we could do it for, you know, the specific heat. You'll have to work out the dimensionality of the specific heat, some guarantee of free energy. And this dimension is going to be heat. I'm not even sure. You have to check this, okay? You can work out the dimension, work out the same argument, and you get an answer. All of these quantities are controlled by one number. Okay? That is the dimension of the scaling dimension, the exact scaling dimension of the one relevant object.
So are we saying this is like universal, like does it depend on the quantity here?
No, it depends, but only in a rather trivial way. It depends on the dimensionality of the quantity. Okay? Because this was of order length, it scaled like 1 by lambda. Something that is dimension 2 was scaled like lambda squared. And then you replace lambda squared by c. Okay. Now, this covers a large range of observables. But there is one more observable that is typically measured that this does not have. And that observable involves two point functions or one point function, let's say the surfaces, the magnetizations. As we take delta j a little above jc, as we've seen, the spin operator itself develops a magnetization. Okay? The spin operator itself develops a magnetization. And once again, you can ask, how does the magnetization vary as a function of delta j? Okay? Now, for this quantity, what question are we asking in the quantum field theory? The quantum field theory we're asking is, out what is the expectation value of phi as a function of the energy. Okay? And in computing these quantities, there is one further subtlety. One further subtlety that I've referred to but not stressed enough. And that is this. You see, when we did the renormalization group flow, this Brzezinski type renormalization group flow, I talked about the operators like m squared, phi squared, operators like phi to the 4. But I never talked of the operator del phi. Can somebody remember? I mentioned this briefly, but I got to pass. Can somebody tell me why I never refer to that as an operator? It's because, this is what you want to say, it's because when you're doing a path integral, you're always free to change the variable of the path integral. You're doing a path integral over phi. You're always free to, at successive steps in the renormalization, always free to rescale phi if you want. And this rescaling can always be done so as to send one number to one. Since in a free theory, the kinetic term controls all physics, it's conventional to use that rescaling free. But we're doing our renormalization group flows. Okay? To set the del phi squared term always to 1. We integrate out a shell. That will, in general, rescale del phi squared. Okay? And then we rescale phi to get rid of that. So once we have accounted for that quote-unquote trivial fact, okay? There's one less operator than the number of terms in the branch. That's why we always set del phi squared to 1, using that figure. Now, this is a trivial fact if you only observe anything measurable that does not involve phi. But of course, if you want to observe something that involves phi, then it's not trivial. Okay? So, this, the quantity that you have to rescale. Now, when you approach a fixed point, just like any other operator, del phi squared also gets, picks up a beta function. You can get rid of that beta function by accompanying the integrating out with a change of variables of phi. Okay? But suppose I am forced to do a change of variables of phi such that phi is equal to as a function of lambda is equal to lambda by times lambda naught to some form. So phi lambda times phi lambda. Okay, as we in the neighborhood of a fixed point. Suppose this is the kind of rescaling that we have. Okay? Let's call give that power some name, let's call this. This rescaling, by the way, is sometimes called wave function renormalization in the high energy literature. Okay. Okay. Now, suppose I want to conclude. Okay? So what we conclude from this relationship is that if this is the kind of risk getting weighed up, phi lambda naught, the original spin, okay, is related to phi lambda by lambda naught by lambda to the power c. But phi lambdas have the same expectation value. Okay? And therefore, expectation value is phi lambda naught. Scale like this, and then we substitute for delta, what our lambda is. Okay? So scale like delta j to the power c by 3 minus mu. Okay? And you would have a similar analysis for two-point functions of spin operators. Okay, which I won't go through, it's a bit more complicated, but it's... So, all observables that are independent of insertions of the spin operator, this phi operator, governed by one number, namely the dimensionality of the relevant operator. Objects are involved in addition. Okay, insertions of the spin operator are governed by two numbers. The dimensionality of the Riemannian operator plus the this thing is sometimes called the dimensionality of phi. This wave function. Okay, the extent to which you have to do this renormalization as you do the renormalization function. It would be connected with how phi would, the beta function for phi, if you allowed an insertion for that. We didn't do that because that's another way of saying it. The other way of saying it is that if we allow an insertion for phi in the Lagrangian, okay, we allowed an insertion for phi in the Lagrangian, we weren't doing that because we were restricted to theories with phi goes to minus phi. But if we allowed an insertion for phi in the Lagrangian, then there would be a second relevant object. And its dimension would be the second number that governs renormalization group. Now, I have to say that these two relevant operators come on different footing. Because all our UV fixed points are assumed not to have zero component of the second relevant operator. Because by symmetry, this phi goes to minus phi. It's only something that appears in observables, but not in describing the flows itself. Okay, so it's slightly different logically.
Why
do
we find the phi of lambda naught? We should be finding the exception of phi of lambda.
No, it is what you actually do. You know, you've got an Ising model, and you want to know what are the expectation values of the spins. Now, the spins are phi of lambda. Phi of lambda is a theoretical device, something that we've introduced to make our renormalization group flows look nice. But what you're actually measuring are the spins. We want to know what is the expectation value of the spins. You know, you've got an experimentalist, but he's not doing a renormalization group flow. He's just measuring. No, he's measuring, see, there's a variable change. What he is measuring is a variable phi of lambda. It's true, it's measuring that scale. Okay, see, what was happening? There were two things happening. There was a path integral where we did the integral from 0 to lambda. But then there was also an insertion. What you wanted to do was e to the power minus s and some function, you want to compute an expectation value of phi. This was your original goal, to measure the expectation value of the spin. Okay? Now, in doing this, you did part of this path integral, and as a theoretical device, you introduced a new path integral variable, which was phi. Our renormalization group flow analysis told us that theories with the same values of RG parameters, the RG parameter determines the expectation value of phi of law. But that's not what we actually wanted to measure. So in doing that variable change, you will pick up this extra factor. Do you understand? This is what we wanted to measure. We relate it to something that is simply determined by the RG. And that's related by the sign. Is this clear? Okay, very similar point for two-point functions of phi. In phi naught, we do this with change, so we pick up two such factors. Then apart from distance.
Why did you scale it?
We say that in doing the algae flow, when you do the integration out of these things, apart from this number changing and this number changing, this microbes have changed. Now, in the analysis that we did, we always, if you can do two things. You can either keep track of that. But that's not what we did, because we didn't call the del phi squared a relevant operator. Our attitude was that two path integrals are the same if they're related by a change of variables. So, in order to fix that ambiguity, we put a condition. We would always write a path integral. Okay? So that the del phi squared term was 1. By changing our variables. Okay? That change of variables near the fixed point, like everything else, takes the form of a power. We don't know what the power is because we're just doing abstract analysis. But we assume that the power is some number c, which is related to the scale dimension of the operator phi itself. Is this clear? Okay.
So C is comparable to 3 minus mu, then this expectation value of lambda doesn't blow up, right?
Yeah, it could blow up, blow down.
So it essentially depends on both C and mu, right?
It depends on the sign of C. So now, you see, the way I've written it, C would be negative. You see, because this is the scaling dimension of the operator phi. In the free theory, this quantity would in fact be minus 2.5. Because phi is scaling dimension half in 3 dimensions. Okay? And C is 3 minus that quantity when written as lambda naught. It's minus 3. So in this particular case where C would be negative, so it would not at all blow up. In fact, that's what you expect. The magnetization is zero at the critical point. It changes to something small as you go away. Okay? So, in fact, let me give you better notation. Okay? Let me write this as lambda naught by lambda to the 3 minus, I call that, this one mu, let me call this 3 minus eta. 3 minus eta. I call that eta. Okay. Okay. Then I'll replace this by 3 minus eta over 3 minus eta. And now this eta and mu are very traditional, for high energy physicists, very, very familiar things. Nu is the dimension of the operator phi squared. And eta is the dimension of the operator phi. Is this clear?
Can you repeat the last one?
Of the operator phi. You put an insertion of phi into the path. It would have its own beta function. Okay? Nu would be the dimension of the operator phi. Okay? So in the free theory in particular, nu would be half and beta would be. Phi lambda, okay. x and 0. Okay? We'll have some particular dependence x, some power. Okay? And then the rescaling will do two things. It will change this x, but it will also change the phi. Yes. That's what it means. Well, let's not get into the analysis of two-point functions now. That's more common. We're going to do that systematically. I analyze correlation functions. Let's not get into that. Okay? The main thing is you get the idea, right? That for observables not involving explicit insertions of the string, all the critical exponents are governed by one number. Dimension of phi squared. Okay? For observables involving insertions of the spin, all particular exponents are governed by two numbers. Okay? If you could measure these two numbers calculated, then your predictions for all these critical exponents. By the way, because all these different critical exponents are governed by just two numbers, independently of being able to compute these quantities, you can predict relations between them. These relations are famous relations in stack-make books, you know, that the various independently measured exponents will be various relations. They don't give my notation, okay, so they look unfamiliar, but they're various different relations. These were, of course, experimentally known before they were predicted. Very simply explained by RG flow analysis. But the really impressive thing, as we will start to see this immediately, is that theorists have also managed for the Kaizen model to compute these exponents. These exponents, not exactly, but in successive approximation schemes. Okay? And I've got results that are very, very good with the critical exponents of measured systems. Okay? So this is really a triumph for theory. This very abstract way of thinking of normalization of group flow led to the understanding of what you should compute. Just these two enormous dimensions. Then there's a relatively simple problem. I mean, once you know what you have to do, you can do it. And you do it, and then you go to the lab and it works. It's really quite an amazing thing. Yeah.
Sir, I have a question. Sir, can you just say what
forget dimensions. Anomalous dimensions is the difference between the dimension that you would have in the free theory and the dimension you would have if you actually did. Yes?
Yeah. So if you have a term which is phi of the Lagrange or the Hamilton in this case,
yes,
then you would have the Lagrange operator corresponding to it, but then if you are considering the deviation to the fixed point as j equals to jc plus j, you would also have that.
Yes, then it would be a two parameter theory, so two relevant operators. So then it's more complicated, a different analysis. But you see, that's not what we do.
Yeah, I understand that, but I'm worried about whether this relation will hold, because then you have to.
It will hold, you see, because there are we're doing two different things. There are observables and the theory. Where demanding that the theory always have the phi equal to minus phi symmetry. Because our initial starting Lagrangian.
No, that's why I said, the Lagrangian has a phi term.
No, but I'm saying the Lagrangian does not have.
That's not us. That's fine. Then
because we've got j, si dot sj, which has symmetry under s goes to minus s. That symmetry forbids the phi. Okay. Lagrangian did not have it. But observables you choose to measure with that Lagrangian could violate the symmetry. Nobody can stop you from measuring the symmetry.
No, that I understand.
Yes,
if it had.
Yes, then you have to do more complicated
stuff. Then the scaling analysis.
Then this scaling would not work. Then you would have to independently, you know, try to understand. It's less powerful. It's less powerful. Because you wouldn't know. You would have to do a two parameter set.
So,
two.
Like deviation from a line rather than from a point in that case.
Yeah, you would have to tune two parameters. This delta j would be a delta j1, delta j2. And you wouldn't know how delta J1 and delta J2 correspond. And then you have to, you see, what did we do? We did something very simple. We said, we've got some delta J. And though we cannot solve the renormalization group flow equations in detail, it's totally plausible that the deviation, that the parameter that governs the relevant operator was linear in this delta t. Okay? Now you have two parameters. Some x1 and x2. So some a1 and a2 behind these flows. Are you understanding what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Okay? And you have two delta t's. And you cannot use a general argument. You know that a1 was alpha times delta j1 plus beta times delta j2. And a2 was gamma times delta j1 plus delta times delta j1. But you wouldn't know what these alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Okay? So there will be more parameters then in your analysis. So less satisfying. The really powerful, straightforward results come about in the case where you have just a single. You can still do some analysis. It's not like empty, but it's not as sad. Okay, other questions, comments? Okay, so now, one more general thing. One more general thing that I wanted to discuss before going on to this larger calculation that I'm going to present. And the general thing was Mendel's problems. Okay? You know, there's always this interplay between what high energy theorists do and dense matter people do, or whether you're looking at renormalization proof flows down there or up there. There's always interesting, confusing, and profitable. Okay? This relation that I talked about. How delta j, changes as a function. It can be worded in a high energy way. Okay? That I want to do for you. Just put that. So let me write. I'll do that and write the relationship a little more seamlessly. Okay. So as we have said. Okay, if you had some sort of RV flow like this, in this particular situation, okay, suppose we started out at scale lambda naught. And suppose we had x2 at scale lambda naught. So, yeah, now suppose we are doing what we started out into this region. Suppose we constructed at scale lambda, now we're not doing the isomorph. We're trying to construct a quantum field. So we're trying to construct a quantum field theory by starting out with a sample Lagrangian of del phi squared plus m naught squared phi squared plus phi to the 4 plus g phi to the 3. Okay? And we start out with this with m naught and g naught at scale. Okay? As always, we always non-dimensionalize every quantity with scale of interest in scale lambda naught. So m naught squared by lambda naught squared is equal to x2, and g naught. Now we're in three dimensions. Okay, let's stick to three dimensions. So we're in three dimensions. So g naught divided by lambda. This has dimension 2. Okay. So this g naught is a dimension 1 object. Is equal to this. 2 and 4 just refers to 2 5s. Okay. Now, we know we've got this. We know, we strongly suspect, and we're going to show in this larger calculation next time. That we've got this renormalization group flow that goes to this fixed point. And that involves one tube. Okay? So, in order to get to this fixed point, as we will see, there's a sense in which we'll have to take this G0 tube. That this G0 will be an irrelevant operator. Okay? You've seen this, right? You already know what it is. Because G naught flows like this, it's an irrelevant operator. What? What is the dimension 3? In dimension 3, yes. I'm doing this in dimension 3. What?
Then
G naught is irrelevant. Then G naught is, sorry, I should have said irrelevant. Yeah, we know that phi naught, that this G naught is an irrelevant operator. G naught looks relevant, but that's about the frequency. Okay, about the interacting fixed point, as we're going to see based hopefully in this section, G naught will turn out to be. We already know this because this is a picture of the flow. The G naught flows in, and not flows in. Okay.
You can't say G naught is relevant.
Right? It's something some other direction. Yeah, right. And that's a bad use of language. What all I should say is that I only need to start with a one parameter set of Lagrangians in E. Okay. So if I start with this for any given G naught, which is set to some x4 naught, I hold it fixed. It doesn't matter what value. Okay? Then if I take x2 and tune x2 as a function of lambda naught, that should help me define my quantum field. That's all that I really wanted to say. Okay? Now, what I'm going to try to understand is how the tuning I have to do for x2 as a function of lambda naught is related to the dimension of this one relevant operator. Okay? Of the dimension of the one relevant operator out there. Okay? And the analysis here is completely analogous to the one we did in the condensed matter language. It's in fact the same analysis, but I'll just do it again so that you see it's answering this question. Have you understood what the question is? It is, the question is, in order to define the quantum field theory, what I do is start with some UV Lagrangian of this one, with x2 chosen as a function of lambda naught. And then I take lambda naught to infinity. And I want to know how I will have to take x2 naught as a function of lambda naught to infinity in order to land up at the same point. Is this clear? Okay. So, you see, as we have seen before, what we want is x2 as a function of the quantity. The actual x2 is a function of lambda, we want to hold that fixed to something particular. Okay. Suppose we say that x2 as a function of lambda is equal to some a. We want to hold that fixed. Let's suppose this is our renormalization. Okay? Now, how does x2 vary as a function of lambda, vary as a function of scale under the renormalization rule? We know that, right? We know that x2 in the neighborhood of the fixed point for lambdas that are near such that you reach the fixed point is equal to some alpha. Okay, so let's call this lambda I. Okay. Some alpha times lambda naught, lambda IR by lambda naught to the power 3 minus theta. And then since we know that we want x2 as a function of lambda IR to be A, of the operator phi square. You call that mu. I got it. Okay. Okay. Now, suppose we choose this scale here, okay, to be lambda naught. Well, lambda, suppose we choose to this scale here to be some number, some scale, which is much, much larger than lambda IR, but still not so large that we're outside this, the scaling regime of the fixed point. Okay? So, let's call it lambda interpoint. So, what we need, what we get here, is that x2 of lambda intermediate. Okay? X2 of lambda intermediate is equal to A lambda IR by lambda intermediate to the power 3 minus 2. Lambda renormalization is A. Okay? This is X2 at an arbitrary scale lambda.
Which is less than lambda.
Doesn't matter, less, bigger. As long as we're in the neighborhood of this point. It's just how X2 behaves as a function. Is this clear? Okay, sorry, I shouldn't have used IR. That I think was that. Okay, so we see that x2 intermediate, okay, x2 intermediate is behaves like this as a function of lambda. Now, you see, to be in the neighborhood of the fixed point at all, there was some x0. So now we go to some our scale lambda. There was some x2 lambda naught critical. Okay? Which would have set us to go bang to the fixed point. So then we would have got x2 equals 0 if we scale it to low enough lambdas. Okay? Now, just like the analysis we did before, the deviation of x2 from x2 lambda not critical. Okay? Whatever that is, the deviation of x2 from x2 lambda not critical, okay, should be linearly related to this x2 intermediate.
Snap trans is your IR or
D. That's
right. It's the same as that lambda renormalization.
Well, no. Lambda naught is the UV scale. Lambda renormalization is the scale at which you're putting a condition. You're defining your theory by demanding that x2 at R x2 at lambda renormalization is equal. Okay? So, basically because of the linear relationship, okay, you can just take this guy here. So what I'm saying is that what we should expect is that x2 at lambda naught should scale with lambda naught, like 1 over lambda naught. X2 at lambda naught minus the x2 at which you would have reached the critical theory. Okay? In the case that this mu here was 1, so that we were dealing with just the free theory, this is simply the statement that if you want fixed mass in the IR, you will fix your mass in the U. Why? Because this delta x2 would scale like 1 by lambda naught square.
We're fixing,
yeah. But this quantity is some very small quantity. And this is linearly related.
Yes.
to delta of x2 naught. You see, what this x2 here is the deviation from this fixed point. There is some flow that would take you back to the fixed point. That flow may be x2 naught equal to 0. It may be x2 naught equal to something else. Okay? So the deviation from here should be proportional to the parameter that tells you how your flow line deviates from the critical. Is this clear?
That's
the equation to
right?
Well, that, yeah. This is
the
x2 intermediate.
No, but then it's always you're looking at the difference between the two flow lines at every interesting flow. Either all are x2 or none.
Yeah.
So again,
no, but but you see, in the neighborhood of this fixed point, the critical flow line is x2.
But there is
what?
For a lambda intermediate, it is a...
No, okay. This lambda intermediate is it is much larger than lambda normalized, but still, so that you can always, so that you're working in the
lambda intermediate is this point on the left side.
No, that's lambda naught.
Yeah, so you're replacing lambda intermediate with lambda naught.
I'm just saying there's a linear relation between it.
Okay.
I'm saying that, and see, if you worked here, you would get, if you worked here, you would get the relationship I got. Okay? But then there's a linear relationship between, see, if you want, I could write this as delta x2, but it wouldn't make a difference. Because in the flow, in the neighborhood of here, the critical guy has x2 equals 0.
Okay, suppose you say lambda intermediate is such that we are near the critical point.
Yes.
I mean, how do you interpolate to get to lambda naught?
Yeah.
I mean, this is a fishy step.
Right. The assumption here is that that there's no non-analyticity in that interpolation. Let me draw around. Good, it's a good question. It was the same question that you could have asked for the condensed matter. Okay? You see, for a long time we have flows here, but then we deviate. Okay? So, the question is that suppose, you know, there's some parameter here that describes the deviation of this flow line from this guy. Where you hit here will be proportional, okay, to this deviation. After that, you're governed by the physics of the fixed point. And that's this. Okay? So this lambda intermediate was really my thing here. You see, where we first start leaving.
Okay, so you're writing x to lambda naught is proportional to delta x to lambda intermediate and proportional to delta x to lambda naught.
Exactly. Are you understand? Is this clear? Okay. So, this delta x2 and lambda naught scaling like 1 by lambda naught squared is the behavior of the free theory, which just tells you that delta mass squared is equal to constant. Okay? Because x2 was equal to mass squared divided by lambda naught. X2 lambda. Okay? So in the free theory, this just tells you that, you know, you don't have to, that as you change lambda naught, in the free theory with appropriate regularization scheme, even you won't even have to worry about the delta. Okay? You just hope the mass fixed. Okay? That's this funny scheme. Okay? However, if you have to scale this mass with some other power, then you can, by reading off that power, from reading off that power, read off the scaling dimension of the mass square. Is this clear? Okay. So now if we're given half an hour more today, now we're going to leave generalities and start doing a particular calculation. Okay. And that particular calculation of the particular thing is the calculation in in phi to the fourth. In large n phi to the fourth. Okay. So what I'm going to do now is an exercise that's great fun. Okay. It's great fun because all these abstract concepts, all these abstract things, can be illustrated very simply. Or some of these abstract things can be illustrated very simply in a place where the calculations are most trivial. Okay? And what I'm going to do is to, you know, use this theorist's trick. Okay? The theorist's trick is the following. Given a problem that you cannot solve, deform it to a problem that you can solve. That retains some of the features of the problem that you cannot solve. And, you know, what theorists really like to do is that relate it to the problem that you cannot solve by a parameter. So that the parameter large is the problem you cannot solve. The parameter small is the problem you can solve. You can solve it small and expand around and hope one day to go from there to there. Okay? So it's not like it's just a different problem. It's a one parameter set of problems, deformable to the parameter that you wish to solve. So, the problem I want to solve is to find the new fixed point. Understand the physics. It's a new fixed point of this point of the fourth theorem. Okay? And I cannot solve the problem because in general, it's going to be a strongly cut off theorem. Okay? One way of addressing this is to work in D minus epsilon dimensions. Or 4 minus epsilon dimensions. And that's something we will probably get to in some the serious analysis of that. Something we'll probably get to in some discussion. But there's another way of deforming this that's very pleasing. And much simpler.
Sorry. Can make an analogy to what you're talking about right now?
Yes.
So the fact that to do this well, we can find a specific for at 4 minus epsilon dimensions and all that. Is it related to way dimensional regulation works, or is that just a...
No. Okay, dimensional regularization has two major uses. 4 minus epsilon dimensions, where you take this epsilon seriously, okay, to get the Swinson measure. That's a very good use of dimensional. But the second use that's also very, very important, even when you don't take epsilon seriously. Suppose you're interested just in finding a 4 dimensional thing. Okay? Dimensional regularization is a very good regularization scheme just to preserve gauge invariance in a 4 dimensional. Okay? So there are two distinct uses for it. A, as a regulator that preserves symmetries. And B, as a way of interpolating between dimensions. And these two distinct uses are both true, and sometimes one is useful, sometimes the other is not. Is this clear? Okay. So, the theory I wanted to solve was this one. Okay, suppose I start with the Lagrangian, m naught squared, pi squared, plus g naught, times phi to the 4. This is the theory I wanted to solve. Okay? In 3 dimensions. This is the theory that is very tough to solve exactly. Okay? Now, there is a nice deformation of the theory which does this. Suppose you introduce, instead of one scalar field, you introduce n scalar fields. Okay? Let's call them phi. And we take, you know, with our Lagrangian here, the symmetry of phi to minus phi, we look at the Lagrangian that will have symmetry under phi I prime is equal to lambda I j phi j. The lambda I j is an arbitrary O n matrix. Okay? So, preserving this invariance, there's not much else I can, basically the Lagrangian I can write. Okay. Now, you might be thinking, this is a bit crazy. The theory with one field was tough. The theory with two fields would be tougher. The theory with n fields looks like it'd be crazy. But you know, this wonderful thing happens that often happens in physics. absolute times of discriminants. Okay? Then sometimes a theory becomes simpler when learning it is intuitive. Then it is rewarding. Okay? And that's what's going to happen in this case. So, while this theory is hard to solve in a finite end, in the large end limit, it's exactly so. Okay. Before we... So, what is the goal? The goal is to compute this path in any way. That's the goal. Okay? Perhaps with some sources for the findings. Okay? But before we actually start computing this path integral, let's do some rough estimation. See, any path integral like this is a competition between two terms. The first of which I'm going to call energy, by abuse of terminology. And the second of which I'm going to call entropy. Actually, it would really be energy and entropy we would use. Energy is the value of the state of energy. Entropy is the volume over which you have to do the integration. Okay? More precisely, entropy is the log over which you have to do the integration. Because we're comparing the energies of the exponent. Now look. Suppose we've got energy of our theory, okay, being much, much larger than the effective volume over which you want to do your integration, then there will be an obvious approximation for this integral. That is, the integral will be highly peaked about the configuration that minimizes the energy. Because even a small difference in energy, it's not going to happen. Because the gain you get because of volume term in the integral is small compared to the loss because you're going away from the minimum energy. Okay? On the other hand, suppose the volume term was much, much larger than differences in energy. Okay? Then your integral will not be highly peaked around any one configuration. It will in fact sample all configurations equally well. The first limit is what's often called weak. Okay? And you don't have to do an integral, you just solve classical equations. Find a saddle point. The second limit is a limit of strong kind. A well-polished quantum theory is somewhere between these two limits. Because the first it's trivial, the second it's often undefined. Somewhere in between these two limits. So, when we take a limit of the theory, we want to do it in a way so that energy and entropy are common. Okay, so let me try to estimate, let me try and give a crude estimate of how the energy terms in the Lagrangian scale as a function of A. The crudest estimate is that since each of these, this expression has got the sum of the n terms, it looks like the energy term scales like n. Similarly here, but it looks like this energy term here scales like n squared. Because the product of two terms, each of which is sum of n. For this reason, in order to get a good large end limit, what I'm going to do is, as I take n to infinity, I will multiply the parameter by g naught by n and hold g naught fixed as I take n to infinity.
How did you get decoupling enough with strong coupling under this comparison?
Okay, what does it mean for quantum path integrity weakly coupled? It means that you can do perturbation theory around a particular configuration. There's a dominant configuration, then you have a classical configuration. And deviations from the classical configuration is small. That's what happens when the energy happens. So you just find the configuration. Configurations are dominated by something. G is very small, the energy is almost zero. G is very large, the energy is almost zero. That's what we traditionally call strong. Because the major dominates the part.
Yeah. That's the first point is, it's like the entropy term, they don't care about what's happening at the energy. So, like, perturbation theory will work in sometimes the same fractions.
No, no, perturbation theory. You see, perturbation theory is controlled by how much you fluctuate away from a satellite. So for instance, around the classical point, there's a determinant. The determinant gets contributions from fluctuations. For the determinant to be smaller compared to the classical piece, you should fluctuate very much. Okay? G being infinite was this strong coupling because you just, the path integral is truly an integral. You go shoosh, very far from the classical. Okay? So, we need to take this large n limit, taking this g naught and scaling it with respect to n so that this. Okay? We will see as we solve the theory why. Because this term is 90 n squared. This phi I phi I, sum of n terms, times another phi I phi I. This is squared. We wanted this whole thing to scale homogeneously with it. So we divide. There is no g squared. It would effectively. I was just giving an analogy. Yeah, it would be some like this g naught here. But forget this. It was just a news. Okay? It was just to link to something that some people already know. Okay. Now, what about the integration issue? Suppose it turns out, again, we see this in practice. Suppose it turns out that dynamically, each phi field runs over some value, A. Then what is the volume of the integration? It's order A to the power n. So e to the power n log A. This is the entropy. The entropy is also scaling. This looks like a wave function. Okay? So we accept this problem as given to us and try to solve. Okay, suppose that dynamics is going to somehow restrict each phi field to some finite range. Okay, we'll see how this happens. But of some fixed number, let's say, just because there are n phi fields, the net volume of the integration is a to the power n. Okay, therefore, a to the power n, which is e to the power n log a, gives you an entropy volume. Typically, the measure of the entropy is simply the number of fields that you're integrating. That's what I mean. Okay? Both of these scale like n. So it looks like we have a chance of getting a well-posed problem. Once I've scaled my g naught, my g in this one. So we're going to take this as our definition of the problem. And try to solve it. Okay. What we're going to have, want to compute, of course, our correlation functions, S matrices of this model, and so on. But to start with, let's just study the partition function itself. Study this as a thing. We'll very soon be able to analyze or study the partition function with our insertions to include the insertions which are true physical measures. Okay? Now, this quantity is a difficult problem because of the interaction. Without this interaction, we would have had a free theory. Okay? And now there is a trick to get rid of this interaction that some people sometimes call the Hubbard's Tatanovich trick. Okay? It's a very simple trick. Which is as follows. Okay? Write this as d phi I dc. D phi I d sigma exponential of minus del phi I plus m naught squared phi I squared. Okay?
No, I don't know about the action scale, like where the action scale is again.
Just because there were n terms. Now what I'm going to do is the following. I'll write this as plus sigma phi I phi I.
and I suppose minus sigma squared by that's equal to 2 here, sigma squared by n sigma squared by 2 g. Okay, up to a phi of source independent function. Okay, in your mind you should say there's a plus j. So that we can use it to compute all functions. Okay, so up to a source independent term, up to a j independent term, if we integrated out the sigma field, we would get back the same function. Why? See, the sigma equation of motion is simply because sigma is a quadratic field, and moreover, sigma is a quadratic field without derivatives. Okay, it's simply minimizing sigma at each point. Okay. How do we do the minimization of sigma at each point? Well, we can write this here as minus n by 2g0 times sigma minus phi i by n for all things squared. Plus phi i squared by 2 g naught n. So I'm saying this plus this is equal to that. Just by algebra. Is that clear? Okay? And now, written in this way, the sigma equation of motion is very simple. It's simply sigma is equal to this. Doing the path integral set sigma equals to this equation of motion, some determinant of n by g naught, that's some number of guess. So we get sigma is set equal to this, what remains is this, and this is what we set. And you have integral over sigma as becomes an integral. So doing the integral over sigma.
Then we can take
them to the nth term. What? No, we can. That's true. But we don't even need to do that. Gaussian integrals are solved by setting that field equal to the classical field.
It's true, but that
only
means
we
take a stationary
point,
which means
that
n has to be large.
No, no, no. It's a Gaussian integral. Dx e to the power ax squared plus bx plus c up to the determinant is the same thing as setting x equal to its classical value, where the n is large. This is an exact statement. No large statement. Okay. Where? No. This sigma does not take. No. Because you see, because this is what I wanted to produce. Is this? So I should do this. Thank you. Okay. Now that I've written it in this way, now that I've taken my theory and I've written it in this language, doing the path integral over phi is trivial. Okay? Because phi is numbers. Okay? Doing the path integral over phi is going to give us some determinant. Now, there are n phi's. The path integral over each of these n phi's is identical. And therefore, you'll get some determinant to the power n. If I exponentiate the determinant, okay, I get n times something. This was the statement that the entropy, the integral over phi, is of order n. That we get n times something. That something will be some function of sigma. Plus, there's an explicit function of sigma. That's this.
that something will be a function of sigma because this sigma. And then there's an explicit function of sigma. This is also multiplied by it. So what we're going to get in the end is, after we do that phi integral, is some path integral over sigma, where the full action for sigma is multiplied by n. Now, you see, we are in a situation where entropy and energy don't compete. Because now energy is n. It's an explicit n. But the remaining path integral left is just the path integral over sigma, which is one path. So the entropy is one. So in this situation, now we can forget we're doing an integral and just minimize the action. Okay?
So we have just manipulated the interaction term to write it as a non-interacting field theory and then use what?
Well, it's not really non-interacting because there are two fields. It's non-interacting as far as phi is concerned. It's a non-interacting theory interacting, I mean, in the presence of a background field.
Yeah, and so then now we have used what we do in statistical mechanics, like z is z1 to the power n, like for non-interacting.
Exactly. As far as phi integral is concerned, it's just exactly.
This introduction of sigma and all, why do we need to make these n fields for that? That we can do.
We can do it for anything, but for what I'm saying, so far everything I said is exact. But for what I'm going to say now, it is important. Okay, for what I just said. What I said was that now, in terms of sigma, we've got an n outside the overall action. Therefore, this integral can be done by saddle points. Leading on a large n, we just have to extremize the action with respect to sigma. We don't have to do a path integral as a function of sigma. We only have to solve sigma, the classical equation of quotient for sigma. But where we use for sigma the full quantum effective action for sigma, full action that we get by integrating on phi, including the term coming from the measure of phi. Now, I said all this before writing an equation because it's plausible that when you minimize the sigma field will be translation invariant. Okay, so what's the logic? The logic is that we should be doing this path integral over phi for all possible sigma fields, and then choosing the sigma field that minimizes its action. But you know, it's often the case that, you know, that just the vacuum is translation invariant. Okay, so it's plausible that in the vacuum, sigma will be translation invariant. If that's the case, because we never need a path, an integral over sigma, we can set it to be translation invariant to start with. Okay, making this assumption, we lose nothing. You see, it's very important that this doesn't work if you're doing a path integral over
sigma. Translation
invariant
goes
to the translation of sigma or in x? In x. X1, x2. Okay? So what I'm going to do is to assume that the extremum of sigma will happen where sigma is independent of x1, x2, x3. If that's the case, just already here in this path integral, I can set sigma equals to a number because of our procedure, we're not going to be integrating over different field configurations. Okay? And then the whole procedure I talked to you about becomes very practically new. Because you see, then this sigma just shifts the epsilon square. Okay? And then the determinant for these phi fields is very simple to compute. This doing the path integral is just computing this determinant. And can you see this just gives you half n integral d3p over p squared over 2 pi cube. 1 over p squared plus m naught squared. Okay, so the whole contribution to the minus.
Right.
So the net effective action for sigma, S effective, is equal to this plus minus. Because this is a number multiplied phi by phi. This is also a number multiplied phi by phi.
This is a number because we are considering this transition.
Because we are assuming that it's transition. For an
arbitrary sigma field, you're more complicated.
This is not an exact statement, because minimum value, we know it's 5a5 sigma.
What was it again?
We know that the minimum value of sigma is 5a5. So, putting sigma translation into sigma constant is not exact. You can approximation.
I know is 5i5i. Right.
Rather,
this is phi i as a function of x. Phi i of x, phi i of x.
Okay?
And because this is a sum of this quantity here, so this is another way of saying it. You see, value of sigma, which is what you know this thing will compute, even if you thought of it as phi ix, you would expect to be independent of x. Just because the whole vacuum is translationally invariant. So no, I don't think there's any approximation. You see, one approximation that will come about, okay, what is true is that if you were to try to include higher order connections in 1 over n, in 1 over n, we would now need to do a path integral over sigma with this action. And then we would need to know the action from things that go beyond constant sigma.
Up to 1 over n.
That's right. Okay, can you see that the final thing is d sigma into the power minus x? Where S effective, evaluated on constant configuration of sigma, exists. Okay? Can everyone say that the path integral over the phi i's gives you that n by 2, blah, blah, blah? Determined,
right?
We're just evaluating the determinant. Is this clear? Okay, excellent. Now, in the leading large n approximation, what do we have to do? Log is
log as this irregularly sigma small. Log plus sigma times 1 over this, this propagator, plus sigma squared times 2 over this. Each of these sigmas will carry some momentum. And to actually compute this for an arbitrary sigma phi, you draw an explicit expression, it's a difficult thing. Okay? While this expression is formally exact, it's not very useful. However, were sigma to be a constant, then it's very simple. Because this is just a shift of the mass. Now, at finite entropy, it's not sufficient to know what it is for sigma equals constant. Because we have to integrate over all values, it's a sigma phi. But at large n, only that value of the sigma phi contributes, which extremizes the action. Because whole action is proportional to n. So if the value that extremizes the action is translationally invariant, then we only care about this action of translationally invariant points. So when we make an assumption, the assumption is that the saddle point at this field, the dominant saddle point, is translationally invariant. It's an assumption, but it's a reasonable assumption.
Wrote down the action as dou squared n squared plus 0 mod of sigma plus truncation of 0 mod.
Right, okay.
And then I would get it right.
This is the full action, right?
Yeah, no, yeah. No, like I'm still not put sigma constant yet.
Yes, this is exact.
Yeah, okay. So I would think, I would like try to expand sigma around the 0 mod.
You should expand it around the 0 mod, exactly.
Yeah. So I get exactly those diagrams.
You get these diagrams.
But they have the same number of loops, right? So you get the same order in it.
Yeah, yeah. So it's true. It's true that all of these things are the same order in it. It's just an O-N overall concept.
Yeah.
But the point is that we don't need to do an path integral over sigma. Because of the overall N, the full path integral over sigma is dominated by that configuration, which extremizes the action.
It need not be constant sigma.
It need not be constant sigma. But then that would be the statement that this field theory breaks translational invariance in its action. Okay? If we assume that is not the case, it's unusual, right? It's unusual for a field theory to have non-translational invariance. Okay? So there's an assumption here.
Okay, so if n was not large, having a non-constant sigma would not break translation.
You have to do a path integral. The dominant configuration could have a translation invariant sigma. But you have to integrate over all configurations of sigma, including non-translation invariants. You understand? Say something very simple. Let me say it. Okay? Suppose I have an e to the power minus f of x. And I'm doing this integral dx. I cannot do this integral without knowing f at all x. But suppose I have e to the power minus n f of x. In the large n limit, I only need to know f in the neighborhood of its minimum.
Isn't it bothering me? Is that in Stanford and Goldberg and all, below you take constant sigma, that is the mean free theory.
But look, that is not exact. But what we have done here is very careful. It's true, we're working in a place where mean field of something is exact, but it's not mean field of the phi field. Okay? You see, it would have been very wrong, okay, to try to do mean field theory of the phi field. That is just to extremize the action of the phi field. Because that would ignore the major contribution, which was also ordering. What we've done is to do that mean field theory correctly in a place where it's justified. Okay? Mean field for sigma is exact and justified by the large n. Mean field for phi would not have been. Okay? Why would mean field for phi not have been exact? Because their entropy and energy were comparable.
Right.
So even though the action is order n, entropy is also order n. It's wrong to throw one of their
in favor of the other. But now we've done little clever. We've explicitly obtained the entropy term. That's order n. The remaining integration is volume order 1. Right? So we've done some work. Oh, sorry. Okay, I should soon stop. We won't complete our analysis of that today. But almost. It's actually very simple. Okay. Great. Now, assuming that sigma is translational invariant, how do I find what translational invariant value sigma takes? That's really simple. I find the equation of motion of sigma. I extremize this action. Okay. So I get the equation n by 2 integral of p squared plus m squared plus sigma minus n sigma by p naught. N is overall, so we forget about it. This equation is sometimes called the gap equation. Okay? And this is the equation, and it's an equation that, logically speaking, determines sigma. Okay? The logic is we determine sigma in terms of our bare parameters m0 and g0.
So finding sigma
is
equivalent to integrating out sigma, right?
Equivalent integrating out sigma in the larger limit. Yeah. Because
sigma
is equivalent. Okay? So we've got this nice gap in. Okay. Now, what may already be plausible to you is that the propagator, and we'll show this in detail, and the propagator of the phi fields is simply 1 over p squared by m0 squared plus sigma. Okay? So, then I'm going to show you another way of deriving the same equation without ever introducing sigma, just doing diagrammatic. Which will help you understand the situation better. Okay, suppose we never introduced the sigma field, but just the diagrammatics of phi. And I wanted to compute the problem here. So I'm drawing final diagrams. Now, what I want to know is which final diagram contributes? Why is this a question? It's a question because you remember that the interaction term was g0 by n, phi I, the whole thing squared, by 2. This interaction term explicitly has a factor of 1 by n. Therefore, only those final diagrams that will contribute, in which the 1 by n is explicitly cancelled. By an explicit factor of n. How would you get 1 by n terms being cancelled by an explicit factor of n? Look at this diagram. Suppose I have I, j, j. This diagram involves a loop of the j field. Okay? This diagram involves a loop of the j field. Okay? But it's a loop of the j field, which value of j is an undetermined. So you have to sum over all values of j. So you get an explicit factor of n in this diagram that will cancel the one of n. So this is a diagram that will contribute to the in the larger limit. On the other hand, let us look at a diagram that will not contribute. Okay. Let us look at, for instance, this diagram. Suppose we have this is I. This is I. And let's say this was the index I, this was j, this was j. I is fixed, is held fixed, these are the external lines that we're measuring the propagator direction, phi I. Okay? Each of these vertices was g naught by n. But number of j's that you sum over, it's just one. So we get the explicit factor rate. So this diagram gives you a self-energy contribution that's proportional to n by n squared. So 1 over n, which we're not going to keep in the logic. So you see, without introducing this funny sigma, okay, just doing diagrammatics, we see that this larger limit has some simplifications. If we're going to keep those diagrams that contribute in the larger limit, each time we introduce a vertex, we need an additional index. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Our failure here was that we introduced two vertices, but only one index. Whereas here, we introduced one vertex and one index. You understand what I mean by index? Summation over indices. Now, if you think about it, you will easily convince yourself that the only diagrams that contribute are cactus diagrams. You can see why you call these cactus diagrams. Okay, nothing else will. Each of these diagrams obviously contributes. Okay, each of these diagrams obviously contributes. Because every time I put a new loop, I've got a new index. And you can convince yourself that no other diagram does. For instance, and these cactus is just gonna go on, right? You couldn't get a cactus diagram like this. That's not an acceptable cactus. Okay. It's because the number of vertices is 1, 2, 3, 4. And the number of index loops is 3. Okay? If it has gone off on its own, that's fine. So the cactus is going to meet. Just like trees. It's forever branching. Okay? Is this clear? Now, you see, this cactus diagram has a recursive structure. The recursive structure is so that, look, suppose what grows any branch of a cactus is itself a cactus. Okay? This allows you to do the following. Suppose we write the exact self energy, which is the sum of all these cactus. We give the following notation to denote that exact sum. Okay, this is equal to this plus this plus this and so on. All these cactus graphs are denoted by this. Clearly, because exact propagator is bare propagator for self energy and bare quadratic term for self energy. That's my definition. But can you see? Now, so let's denote this exact propagator by this W. Can you see that we get the equation sigma is the one loop graph obtained with the exact propagator? Because you see, each of these cactus insertions that go off this, each of the cactus graphs is simply a cactus itself, growing off the original one. It can go off at many points, but that's the geometrical progression summation of the sigma. Okay? And therefore, we get the equation, but this we know in terms of sigma. Okay, this we know in terms of sigma. This was sorry. What did I say? I said sigma
was equal to was this. But this is simply equal to d3t by 2 pi over q. Okay? 1 over p squared plus m squared plus c. What? Now I've missed out some factors. Plus times g naught. And maybe if I'd done it a bit carefully, I would have got g naught there too. Okay? I have to do that carefully. And that's the vertex factor. Let's do that. I'll do that in a minute. But you see that this is the same thing. My capital sigma is the same as the sigma. Okay. Is this clear?
Sir, that equation you're getting by differentiating this equation, right? So shouldn't we have a square in the denominator?
Where?
Like this equation.
This equation?
The next one.
Yes?
Yes, this we are getting by differentiating the action, right?
Yes.
So wouldn't there be a square because we are differentiating with respect to
the equation? In which term?
No, the first, the integral.
But this is log.
Yeah, this integral here. This is wrong. This is where, sorry. This is wrong. Thank you. I wrote that. You see, this is just the log of this operator. The operator is diagonal, some over right. Okay. So you see that these two equations are exactly the same. Okay. Let's get the factor of half right. I better let you go right. Okay. I'll let you just try. But let's get the factor of half. Now the factor of half, I have to track down what my original. I started with g naught phi 4 by 2, right? Yeah, I started with by 2. So I did that by 2. So my interaction that I got into was g naught by 2a, phi i. Okay? And now
I think it's physical invariant.
Once again.
I think it's because you wrote here on Lagrangian is do phase per transfer, phase per transfer, do phase per transfer, phase per bit 2.
I should have written the Lagrangian. Does that matter?
Take out the 2 in the operator direction.
So the Hubbard scenario which only cares about the phi to the
phi. No, phi not the Hubbard scenario.
I mean, if I get p squared, if I do here, that won't matter.
Yeah, that's
awesome. Just let me see if I let me just understand this. Yeah. So suppose I bring this guy down. I get a half. Then there's a choice of 2 for which guy can track. That doesn't seem to be. That looks like the half goes away. Did I do this right? Okay, I'll I'll leave it as an exercise for you to clear up the factor. Okay. No, it's because I'm writing the sum of only self-energy factors. You see, the full propagator and then there's going to be another cactus here. So this quantity is same. So in the GP, it gives you this plus this. What is the total quantity? The total propagator is this. This is equal to the self energy. You see, this is the exact propagator. And the one loop with the exact propagator produces sigma. See, because each of these is one loop with the exact propagator. Not yet. This whole thing is sigma. This you agree? Now I want you to look at what this whole thing is. This whole thing is a loop made out of something. What is the loop made of? You could have a cactus growing here, or a cactus growing here, or a cactus. Each of these cacti is a sigma. Okay? So we're going to do a loop, but imagine a propagator before we close them. It's this, 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 what's the same as this? So it's the exact propagator. Exact propagator is 1 over p squared plus h. That's it. No, still not. Okay, that's it.
Actually, this thing is clear that you are giving p squared plus h squared plus
sigma. You don't need it. Yes.
But why this whole thing is again equal to sigma?
Because you agree that any one of these is sigma. But this is the same thing as one loop with the exact. Can you see that? We have that this is the exact formula. Now, let me close this. Do you see that this is exactly the same as this? One guy on which you built arbitrary number of cacti. It's the recursive nature that makes it. You see this? You see? What is this? Let's go back here. This guy you agreed was sigma. What is it? It's one cactus, on top of which you can grow as many cacti as you want. One loop, on top of which you can grow as many cacti as you want. What is a cactus? A cactus is a loop, on top of which grow an arbitrary number of cacti. You ever done computer programming? Palindrome n if left is equal to right and the reduced word is palindrome. You know, so this trick.
So you're not concerned about how many cactus we have. Every quantity
is infinite. You see, what is this graph? The graph that gives you sigma is one loop, is an arbitrary cactus. But what is a cactus? It's a loop on top of which you can grow an arbitrary number of cactus.
Okay. So the sum of all the cacti is the cactus itself.
This one loop plus arbitrary number of cacti is cactus. Yes. You see. Now this is the propagator. Now what I'm saying is now if I take this and join it up, this is one loop with the exact propagator by definition. But can you see that this is just a cactus? And therefore this is sigma. But that's one loop with the exact propagator. Okay? So, we've got a diagrammatic representation of that same equation that also makes clear the interpretation of that little sigma. That little sigma, of course, in terms of little sigma theory was the expectation value of little sigma. But in terms of phi theory, where we don't care about little sigma, it's just an auxiliary object that we introduced for our own convenience, what was? It's the shift, it's the self energy. Okay? And
this equation here, the cap equation from this point of view is just simple summing of five minutes. Okay, so this is our first equation. Now, what we're going to try to do is to do renormalization this theorem. Probably not. what we're going to try to do is do renormalization in this theorem. What was the whole spirit of renormalization? We have to choose g naught squared, g naught, and m naught as a function of lambda, so as to hold two physical things fixed. Now, there are two great physical things you can hold fixed. Okay? You see, this is how we usually implement this one. You don't actually compute some renormalization group flows to some scale lambda. You instead hold two physical quantities fixed. One physical quantity is the pole in the propagator of phi. So, what pole of the propagator is m0 squared plus c. So, we will hold that fixed. So, we will have to solve this equation subject to the condition that this is equal to m phi. And is held fixed. That is one thing. Okay? The second thing we will do, so that's one condition of two variables. Okay, which is m0 and g0. Okay. Now, in defining the theory about the new fixed point, we will actually need only this condition. Because the second variable will drop out, as we said. But so far, we haven't committed to whether we're going to define the theory for the free fixed point, in which case we need to specify two things, or the new fixed point, in which case we want to specify one thing. In fact, it will be more satisfying to define it about the free fixed point and see the new fixed point emerge as an RG flow, which is what we did. Okay? So, we're going to need a second condition so that we can also specify this genome. Give me 3 more minutes. Yeah, that very, very quickly. I need a second condition. So something else I can compute. I've computed one physical thing, the pole of the propagator. Okay? I'll hold that fit subject to this equation. Because I can compute it exactly. That's a great thing. Exactly 1 over n. No perturbation theory in g naught. Okay? I'm going to compute one more thing. The other thing I'm going to compute is 5 to the 4 scattering. Now, we haven't studied scattering in this class, but you guys have done quantum field theory. Quantum field theory, one was Fourier analysis and some scattering. So you know all about scattering. Okay? So, in this theory, what we want is Feynman graphs that contribute to 5 to 4 scattering. But we only want those that contribute to the large elements. Okay? Does this one contribute to the large element? Let's say we're scattering I, j, g. And that's k. This is 1 over n. So maybe it doesn't contribute, but we have to be careful. Because 3 level scattering in this theory is this, which is also 1 over n. So the rule is that scattering is very weak, but we keep all graphs that are order 1 over n. Because the same is free level. Anything that's further suppressed than 1 over n, we will not. So, now suppose we wanted a graph like this. Okay, here now we have I, j, j, and then there are two other indices. Let's say k, k, l, n. So two index loops, but 1, 2, 3, 4 vertices, 1 over n squared, now we have. Okay. As you can, we can actually do this using the sigma language as well. But you may want, it's sort of interesting and easy to see. But the only graphs that contribute to this. Do these contribute? Yes. Because how many vertices? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How many loops? 1. It does. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1 over n. They contribute. And you can then say that no other didn't contribute. So now, this is very simple. You see, because those have got momentum p1 and momentum p2, momentum p3 and momentum p4, so that's the modulator. 3 and P4. Let's define P1 plus P2 is equal to P. Then what is this graph? This graph is just n iterations of the same basic graph. So if we had P3P divided by 2pi the whole thing cube, same graph we wrote down to compute the beta function for pi to the 4th year, except that it's incremental. 1 over r squared plus sigma plus m, okay, plus m phi squared. Did we say somewhere that m not squared plus sigma is m phi squared? Oh, when I said only these graphs contribute, I like it. Because clearly, cactus graphs built on top of this also. But that's taken account by replacing these graphs by the exact propagator. So it's a large number of graphs that we sum so efficient. Okay? So that's why I put plus m phi squared. And I call this as a capital P. This is P plus R root x squared plus m squared m phi squared. Let's call this whole thing I of P m phi squared. For what I want to say at the moment, the only important thing is that this I of P m phi is uv and ir phi. This is d3p divided by p to the 4th. We're in 4 dimensions. The same graph that gave us that beta function, sorry, we're in 3 dimensions. The same graph that gave us beta function in 4 dimensions, beta function given in log dimensions, here's just a little bit. Okay? So, up to some factor of 2, which I won't try to get straight now, the first scattering amplitude, just this plus this plus this plus this, is just geometric series. Okay? So, what we get is that the S matrix is equal to G naught 1 by n times G naught 1 minus G naught I of P. It's an incredibly simple matrix. Exactly. Exact answer is S matrix for 4 and 2 to 2 scattering. Okay? This is some integral you can try to evaluate now. The thing that I wanted to say at the moment is that whatever the integral is, no UV I have to. So the two quantities that we're going to hold fixed are, let's say, the S matrix at some prescribed moment. Okay? What that will do is fix G naught. But G naught will scale without a lambda. It's fine. So, we might as well say that we're holding G naught fixed. Okay, so we will demand, since this is the form of the S matrix, given by one parameter, we hold this value of G naught is physical. Okay? So we call that G fixed. So G naught is just head fixed. It's the physical value. Physical value. Okay? And then we've got this other equation that we have to adjust. Okay, then we've got this other equation that we've got to adjust in order to get the a physical mass. Okay, we'll see in next class how we do that, how that allows us to build both the free fixed point, which is no great achievement, but also the critical fixed point, and understand the scaling dynamics.